invest in your future. Sky News Financial Reports, sponsored by Interactive Investor.
Well, not long to go now until Rishi Sunak faces Sir Kier Stammer in Prime Minister's questions. We have our MPs ready to discuss what may come up in the Commons. With me for the Conservatives in a couple of moments, she's just coming in, Rachel McLean, MP for Redditch. But in the studio at the moment, for Labour, we have Nick Thomas-Simmons, Shadow Secretary of State for International Trade. And for the Lib Dems, we have Alistair Carmichael, who is the MP for Home Affairs, Justice, Northern Ireland, but also the MP for Orkney and Shetland as well. Lovely to see you both. Nick, to you first of all, in terms of what's happening at the moment, strikes seem to be what a lot of people are focused on today. Do you think this is something that Kier Stammer will push the Prime Minister on?
Well, it's something that I think certainly will come up in the duration of Prime Minister's questions. I haven't got any specific intelligence on Kier's six questions, but of course I would expect that to come up. And I would expect the government's failure to come up as well. I think the government has, at best, been standing on the sidelines trying to pretend it's nothing to do with them, and at worst has been aggravating the situation by threatening highly unnecessary and unwise new laws to restrict the right to strike. This is a government that should be sitting down, getting people around the table, trying to hammer out a solution. That's what we need to see, an active government doing that.
Alistair, do you think that those who are out today and potentially will be out in the weeks coming up to Christmas are justified?
Mm-hmm. Look, I mean, I think the point about strikes has to be put in a proper context here. And one of the reasons why there is so much industrial conflict at the moment is the cost of living crisis. And you've seen that, you know, coming to the fore again this week, Ofgem announcing that the price cap is going to be rising again in the new year. You've got food price inflation this week up at 12.4%. So, you know, that's the root cause of the discontent, the unhappiness that there is in the wider workplace at the moment. And, you know, I think as, you know, the longer that continues, the more you see the inadequacies of the support that's been put in place, the gaps that begin to appear. And, you know, if PMQs is doing its job today, you should see more discussion about that.
Well, we have just been joined by Rachel McLean for the Conservatives. Thanks so much for coming in. We've just been talking about strike action, and we've seen a number of picket lines already today. What do you think the government should be doing? What do you think Rishi Sunak should be doing to get the country back to work?
Well, I think, obviously, we do respect and value all those frontline workers. We know that they're working under pressure, and it is important that we get them back to work because these are vital services that people rely on, whether it's ambulances or whether it's healthcare workers. We do need them back to work. So, look, there is a lot of work going on. I know that the Health Secretary is talking to the nurses, for example, and I'm sure he'll be doing the same with the ambulance drivers. He's having constructive discussions. He'll be continuing to do that because, at the end of the day, our constituents expect those services to be working.
You do value them, and, of course, we all went out during COVID and clapped for these workers. A lot of people will say, why on earth don't you just pay them more?
They are being paid more. So we have... The government has accepted all the recommendations of all the pay bodies. Pay increases have gone in across the board, and that's the right thing to do. But I think we also need to recognise that we can't always accept every pay demand because we do need to also bear in mind the wider picture of inflation. So we have to have these pay settlements guided by the independent experts who look at the cost of living pressures and look at the pay scales across the board. I mean, if you actually look at the nurses' salaries, I mean, of course, there is a scale there. So they are pegged to a lot of indicators to consider the pressures on nurses and others. It is right that we make those decisions and that we pay them what they deserve. But also, we also have to be responsible, of course, with the public finances. And inflation is the issue that's going to actually erode those workers' salaries if we don't get it under control.
Alistair, it's a fair point, isn't it, that the government is using these pay review bodies. It is taking independent advice about what these people should be paid. Aren't they right to then stick to what these bodies suggest?
It is an ever-changing landscape, though, and it's changing at a quite, you know, alarming speed at the moment. And, you know, you see people coming out in strike now, people going out in picket lines and the rest of it. This has not just come out of a clear blue sky. You know, these threats have been there for weeks and months. And yes, it's good that now you've got the Transport Secretary, the Health Secretary talking to unions, whatever. Why on earth was this not happening months ago. You know, it seems to me that it's always the case with this government that, yes, they can be relied upon to do the right thing, but only once they've tried everything else first.
Nick Thomas-Simmons for Labour. Will Labour MPs be out on strikes, on picket lines, supporting their constituents?
No, the Labour front bench will be seeking to get into government, which is the best way that we can help working people. As the General Secretary of Unison, Christina McAnea, has said very clearly, it isn't about Labour MPs on picket lines, it's about Labour MPs getting into power to make a difference for working people. And what we're seeing, frankly...
Has Kier Stammer banned the front bench from going out?
We've decided collectively as a shadow cabinet that that is our position. But the position we are in at the moment, I doubt you could name a single public service after 12 years of Conservative government that is in a better state now than it was 12 years ago. And that isn't the fault of the workers, the frontline workers who've given so much. It's the result of 12 years of Conservative mismanagement. And that now has been exacerbated by the Conservative mini-budget this autumn. We've got now this economic crisis which is made in Downing Street, and working people up and down the country are paying the price.
Rachel, in terms of that, I know you will say, oh, there are global economic consequences to what is going on here. We all know about the war in Ukraine, we all know about inflation across the world. But Nick is right, isn't he, that there is a specific issue in the UK, and it is tied to that mini-budget that has made life a lot worse for a lot of people, especially in terms of mortgage repayments, for example.
No, I don't accept that. Really? Nick is right on this. And actually, if I can sort of challenge what he's just said, we do have more doctors and nurses working in the NHS since 2010, since the last Labour government. We've got record levels of investment going into our frontline services. And, of course, we need to work with those who are delivering the services, including the management, the layers of management, to make sure that that's well spent. But, look, you know, I think everybody now, serious economic commentators, including the chair of the Bank of England, has been very clear that, yes, we did see some turbulence on the back of that mini-budget, but these are not the structural factors that are underlying the UK's economic troubles. And it's one thing for you to say we've heard about Ukraine, but that is the reason why we are seeing our economy struggling with some of the headwinds that it is. Not just Ukraine, the aftershocks of COVID, those global supply factors. So although perhaps you don't want to hear it, it is very important that we do recognise that that is the root cause of some of those problems, and we need to continue bearing down on those.
OK. Rachel, Nick and Alistair, both Nick and Alistair shaking your head as Rachel was speaking there. They clearly not agree with you, but thank you all very much for coming in and looking ahead to Prime Minister's questions. Just also joined by our political editor, Beth Rigby, who's come in now, talking about strikes, Beth. I mean, we don't know what Kier Stammer is going to really push the Prime Minister on, but it is certainly very much the flavour of what a lot of people are talking about.
It is, and I think the way I think this will go today is that Kier Stammer will want to press where he thinks he's quite effective on what he perceives to be Rishi Sunak's weakness, probably highlighting some of those tensions on the back benches. It seems like calm waters, but there is still a lot of unhappiness in the Conservative Party about taxes going up in the autumn statement, and there's these rebellions brewing on housing targets and wind farms. And I think for Rishi Sunak's part, this will be an opportunity for him to try and attack Kier Stammer on what he will say is not standing up to the union. So I think both men will have material in this PMQs today to go at each other. And it has been this back and forth on these two themes has been the tenor of what happened last week as well.
Beth Rigby and Nick Thomas-Simmons for the Labour Party, Alistair Carmichael for the Lib Dems, and also Rachel McLean for the Conservatives. Thank you all so much for joining us. Looking ahead to Prime Minister's questions, it's coming up straight away after this short break. You're watching Sky News. This live is the House of Commons. The Prime Minister is due to start Prime Minister's questions at any moment. While we're waiting for him to take to his feet, we have our political editor, Beth Rigby, here. He's been in the job now, what, about a month almost? Feeling settling into it?
He's been in the job about a month, and he is settling into it, but it's not easy for him to get stuff done at the moment, Jane, because what Rishi Sunak is facing, as we were just talking about, are these rebellions on the back benches around a number of policy areas. So he is in harness, but I think that this is something that Kier Stammer will want to lean in on PMQs about this characterisation of Rishi Sunak as a weak Prime Minister. And as I was saying, I think what Rishi Sunak will want to do is to try to take Kier Starmer to task over the unions, given all of the strike action. And he will say, I imagine, you call me weak, but you don't stand up to unions. I think this will be the tenor of this PMQs. I think watch too to see if Kier Starmer brings up issues around tax raising, because Labour put out this information today suggesting that a windfall tax, if it had been introduced at the beginning of the year, would have raised by now 17 billion. And I wonder if he will also raise the issue of taxing non-DOMs. This is something he talked about last week. Labour putting out the view that that would raise £3.6 billion, pounds, which they would then use to help fund the NHS. So there's a couple of attack lines from Starmer there on Sunak. But as I said, he will have rebuttals in terms of Labour's links with the unions and strike action.
Let's take the Commons.
Join me in congratulating England on last night. Commending Wales for inspiring millions. And also wishing everyone a happy St Andrew's Day. Mr Speaker, this morning I had meetings with ministerial... In addition to my duties in this House, I shall have further such meetings later today.
Tommy Shepherd.
In 2014, his predecessor David Cameron signed up to the Smith Commission, which promised, amongst other things, that nothing in its report would prevent Scotland becoming an independent country should the people of Scotland so choose. Yeah. Can I ask the Prime Minister, does he share that view? And if he does, and in light of last week's Supreme Court judgment, will he bring forward legislation to allow that choice to be exercised?
Yeah. Yeah. Prime Minister.
Well, Mr Speaker, we did have that conversation not so many years ago. It was described as a once-in-a-generation referendum. But, and we discussed this last week. I think what the people of Scotland want is for us to be working constructively together to focus on their priorities. That's indeed what we're doing in his own area, investing hundreds of millions of pounds in a growth deal and ensuring that with a new concert hall, we can enshrine Edinburgh's reputation as a city of culture.
Sir Paul Burrisworth.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I've just returned from the South Pacific and I found there a deep... resisted the All Black jokes, Mr. Speaker, but I found there a deep concern at the expanding tentacles of Communist China. Would my right honourable friend agree with me that China is more than just, as he put it, a systemic challenge, but in fact an expanding, serious geopolitical threat?
Yeah. Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, China is indeed a country with fundamentally different values to ours and an authoritarian leadership intent on reshaping the international order. But actions speak louder than words, and that's why we passed the new National Security and Investment Act. Just recently, we used that act to block the sale of Newport Wafer Fab. And this week, with our announcement of Sizewell C, we ensured that China's state-owned nuclear energy corporation will no longer be a part of the project. This government making sure that we protect our country's security.
We now come to the Leader of the Opposition, Kier Starmer.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. May I join the Prime Minister in saying, well done, England. And I hope we can say that next week and the week after. Yeah. Commiserations to Wales, so I'm sure we'll be back in the World Cup tournament before too long. And of course, Mr. Speaker, we mark that tomorrow is World AIDS Day. Mr. Speaker, Winchester College has a rowing club, a rifle club, an extensive art collection. They charge over £45,000 a year in fees. Why did he hand them nearly £6 million of taxpayers' money this year in what his levelling up secretary calls egregious state support?
Yeah. Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I'm pleased he wants to talk about schools because we recently announced billions more funding for our schools. We're helping millions of the most disadvantaged children catch up with their lost learning. And we're driving up school standards, Mr. Speaker. But during COVID, he wanted to keep schools closed. We shouldn't be surprised because I listen to parents and he listens to his union paymasters.
Mr. Speaker, his levelling up secretary, I see him down there, who, after all, was education secretary for 4 years, said you could scarcely find a better way of ending burning injustices than scrapping these hands out. Yeah, yeah. And here's why, and he talks about driving up standards. Just down the road in Southampton, and he'll know this, 4 in every 10 pupils fail their English or maths GCSE this year. 4 in 10. Is that £6 million of taxpayers' money better spent on rifle ranges in Winchester or driving up standards in Southampton?
Prime Minister, Mr. Speaker, he talks about school standards. It's under a Conservative government, and thanks to the reforms of the former Education Secretary, that now almost 90% of schools are good or outstanding. But Mr. Speaker, Mr. Speaker, whenever he attacks me about where I went to school, he is attacking the hard-working aspiration of millions of people in this country. He's attacking people like my parents, Mr. Speaker. This is a country that believes in opportunity, not resentment. He doesn't understand that, and that's why he's not fit to lead.
Mr. Speaker, if he thinks the route to better education in this country is tax breaks for private schools in the hope they might hand that some of that down to state school, that's laughable. Trickle-down education is nonsense. And, Mr. Speaker, it's not just the levelling up secretary. His education minister sitting there asks, how much better would it be if Conservatives got rid of these handouts? He talks about his record. It's simple. He can carry on being pushed around by the lobbyists, giving away £1.7 billion to private schools every year, or we can put that money to good use. End the Tory scandal. He talks about his record. Hundreds of thousands of children leaving school without the qualifications that they need. I've made my choice. What's his?
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we're improving school standards for every pupil in this country. It's our reforms that are leading to us marching up the PISA league tables for reading, for writing, more good and outstanding schools, more investment in every single school. But he talks about choice. This is about supporting aspiration, Mr. Speaker, and that's what this government is proud to do.
Mr. Speaker, he really does need to get out more. And he talks about aspiration. Mr. Speaker, they are killing off aspiration in this country, and it's not just education. Why is the dream of home ownership far more remote now than it was when his party came into power 12 years ago?
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, what have we done in those 12 years? The highest number of new homes started in 15 years. Largest number of first-time buyers in 20 years. He talked about 10 years ago. What do we inherit? The lowest level of house building in a century.
Mr. Speaker, would you believe it? Mr. Speaker, the simple fact is this. Every year, the age at which people can buy their first home goes up. At this rate, under this government, a child born in the UK today wouldn't be able to buy their first home until they're 45. Now, I love my kids, but I don't want to be cooking them dinner in 30 years' time. Now, Mr. Speaker, I've heard he's having a relaunch. Apparently, it's called Operation Get Tough. So how tough is he going to get with these backbenchers who are blocking the new homes this country so badly needs?
Prime Minister!
Mr. Speaker, we're delivering record numbers of new homes under this government. That's what we're doing. He talks about toughness, Mr. Speaker. He's too weak to stop dozens of his own MPs joining the picket lines. So what if he wants to support those hard-working families and show some leadership, why doesn't he confirm right now that no Labour MPs are going to join those picket lines?
Mr. Speaker, whichever way you slice it, it's always the same. Whether it's private schools, oil giants, or those who don't pay their taxes here, every week he hands out cash to those that don't need it. Every week he gets pushed around, and every week he gets weaker. But I can help him with this one. He doesn't need to do another grubby deal. If he wants to defeat that amendment from his anti-growth backbenchers national targets for housing, Labour will lend him the votes to do so. Country before party, that's the Labour way. Why doesn't he try it?
I think we did hear too weak to confirm no one on the picket line. But, Mr. Speaker, it's the same old Labour ideas. More debt, more inflation, more strikes and more migration. He tells his party what they want to hear. I'll take the difficult decisions for this country. And that's the choice, Mr. Speaker. It's the politics of yesterday with him or the future of the country with me.
As host of this week's International PSVI Conference, the UK again highlighted the need for more action to prevent sexual violence in conflict. With heart-rending accounts of women in Ukraine being brutalised in this way, and reports that a third of women in conflict zones can be victims, will the Prime Minister champion with me as his Special Envoy for Freedom of Religion or Belief the work being undertaken with young people across the world to prevent religion or belief being weaponised, which can later manifest into sexual violence in conflict?
Prime Minister.
Can I say I'm incredibly grateful to my honourable friend for her dedicated work in this area. And she's absolutely right to highlight that this week the UK hosted the Preventing Sexual Violence in Conflict Initiative Conference. It was an incredible success. I pay tribute to all those involved. And as she said, we managed to reach a new political declaration in the conference where over 50 different countries have agreed to put an end to sexual violence in conflict. And she deserves praise for all her work in this area.
Leader of the SNP, Ian Blyford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure the whole House will want to join me in sending prayers and condolences to the wife of Doddy Weir, who sadly passed away at the weekend. The absolute giant of a man, an inspirational figure in Scottish rugby, and someone who raised £8 million for M&D charities over the course of the last 6 years. Our thoughts and prayers are with Cathy, with Hamish, with Angus and with Ben. Mr. Speaker, let me wish everyone a happy St. Andrew's Day. And those that know anything about St. Andrew know that he's not just the patron of Scotland, he's celebrated right across Europe. That is why it is such a sad sight to watch this Prime Minister ram through a bill that would rip up 4,000 pieces of European law. Laws that protect workers' rights, food standards and environmental protections. And it's an even worse sight watching the leader of the Labour Party desperately trying to out-Brexit the Prime Minister. Ruining out freedom of movement and any hope of a Swiss-style deal. Brexit is now the elephant in the room that neither the Tories or Labour are willing to confront. When will the Prime Minister finally see reality and admit that Brexit is a significant long-term cause of the UK economic crisis?
Well, Mr. Speaker, can I start by joining my honourable friend in offering our condolences to the family and friends of Doddy Weir, and I'd also like to pay tribute to him for his campaign to raise awareness of MND, which has made a big difference. Now, Mr. Speaker, straightforwardly, I was proud to support Brexit. It was the right thing for this country. It allows us to, first of all, get control of our borders, which is incredibly important, and reduce migration, all of which, Mr. Speaker, I noticed what he said, and I agree with him actually about the slight dexterity of the leader of the opposition on these topics of free movement. And I know he'll join me in reminding the leader of opposition about his previous promise to defend free movement of people, not something that we support, Mr. Speaker. But we're also seizing the economic opportunities, deregulating, and signing trade deals around the world. That's how we'll drive growth and prosperity.
Ian Blackford.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And can I thank the Prime Minister for his remarks on Doddy Muir? But once again, what we're seeing over Brexit is better together. We're used to that in Scotland. Yep. The problem for both the Prime Minister and the Labour leader is that when it comes to Brexit, even their own voters don't agree with them. The last YouGov poll showed a record 56% now believe it was wrong to leave the European Union. Yeah. And that figure is 71% in Scotland. One in five who actually voted for Brexit have now changed their minds. More and more people across these islands are wise to the fact that make Brexit work is just another stupid slogan. Yeah. Yeah. But Scotland can't be stuck with a new Brexit Together coalition of the Tories and Labour. So on this St Andrew's Day, can the Prime Minister finally tell people in Scotland the democratic path to escape Westminster control, to deliver independence, so we can get back to the European Union?
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, he talks about democracy and votes. I think the difference between him and I is that I respect the result of referendums. He talks about this. Just remember one thing, Mr. Speaker. We had the fastest vaccine rollout in the world. We had that because of our freedoms after leaving the European Union.
Mark Palsy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, manufacturing remains a key part of the UK economy, and for the West Midlands, that means automotive. That's important in my constituency of Rugby, which includes firms in the supply chain and workers at Jaguar Land Rover. With the move to all new cars sold in the UK to become electric by 2030 means that which is critical for us to have a site for battery manufacture. Assembly is already taking place elsewhere in the world where batteries are made, so will the Prime Minister give his support to the bid for a gigafactory in Coventry?
Prime Minister.
I pay tribute to my honourable friend's efforts to progress this project. We're fully committed, Mr. Speaker, to securing investment to grow our electric vehicle supply chain. Now, although he'll know I can't comment on individual commercial negotiations, we did announce in the Net Zero Strategy £350 million of funding in the Automotive Transformation Fund to support the development of that supply chain, and I wish him every success in his bid.
Colin Meeswell.
Yesterday, BBC Northern Ireland announced cuts to programming and jobs at BBC Radio Foyle that, in my view, will leave the station totally unsustainable. The BBC Charter places an obligation on that organisation to allow audiences to fully engage on local issues. This decision, in my view, is a very clear breach of that obligation. Leaving licence fee payers outside the Greater Belfast area without proper local programming. Will the Prime Minister act to defend this very important local public broadcasting service?
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I believe very strongly in local public broadcasting, and indeed the government has taken steps to support local media. I'll be very happy to look at the specific issue he raises and bring it up with the BBC when I next see them.
Angela Richards.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The people of Guildford tell me they want women and girls to feel safe, and I'm delighted to have had some successes in getting lights turned back on, including on York East Bridge, on behalf of concerned students at the University of Surrey. Does my right honourable friend agree with me that even in difficult times, we cannot take a single step back from the brilliant work this Conservative government is doing to tackle violence against women and girls?
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, like my honourable friend, the government is committed to tackling violence against women and girls and making our streets safer. We've created the Safer Streets Fund, which funds additional patrols, extra lighting and more CCTV. And indeed, the Street Safe online tool allows users, including those in her constituency, to pinpoint locations where they feel unsafe so that the local police can take appropriate action. And I'll continue to support her in her efforts.
I've been upon the sorry.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The two boys, 16-year-old boys, Charlie Batalo and Kiani Sianko, were tragically killed in my constituency of Erith and Thamesmead this weekend. My heart goes out to the families and friends left behind. We really need to come across the House to address and tackle serious youth violence. So can I ask the Prime Minister what he is doing to address knife crime epidemic?
Prime Minister.
I thank the Honourable Lady for her question and join her in expressing my condolences to the family and friends of the two boys. I also read about it. It's an awful tragedy. She rightly asked what we are doing to make our streets safer and stamp out the scourge of night crime. We're boosting the number of police officers, as she'll know, 15,000 on our way to 20,000. And we're also giving them the powers they need to get knives off our streets, including lifting restrictions on stop and search and introducing new court orders to target known knife offenders. I agree with her. This is something we need to do more on, and she should know that the government will be fully committed to tackling it.
Gordon Henderson.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. When will my right honourable friend government bring forward any emergency legislation that's needed to deport those migrants who came across the channel illegally in small boats and are now being put up in hotels paid for by hard-pressed British taxpayers? Yeah.
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, we are determined to do whatever it takes to break the business model of people smugglers who are causing the needless loss of life of people across the channel and putting unsustainable pressure on our asylum system. Our Nationality and Borders Act, opposed by the party opposite, Mr. Speaker, gives us new powers which we fully intend to use, and we will take further measures as required to properly control our borders and reduce the number of illegal crossings.
And then back double.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. It was sad to see in a video from his Oxford days the future Prime Minister saying he hadn't a single friend who was working class. And he's not likely to make any soon, because while he sits on a personal fortune, he's refusing the reasonable demands of nurses, railway workers and many others forced to take industrial action just to make ends meet. Why doesn't he give them the wage increases they need and fund it by making the rich pay the same rate on unearned income as workers have to pay for their hard graft? And whilst he's at it, why not scrap the non-dumb tax loophole that he's all too familiar with, which is costing the public £3.2 billion?
Mr. Speaker, I have nothing but admiration and gratitude to our nurses for all the work they do. But Mr. Speaker, Mr. Speaker, it is simply unreasonable and unaffordable to have a 19% pay rise. Now, if that's what the honourable gentleman thinks is, I'm sure the Labour Party can explain to us how they would pay for that and the impact it would have on inflation. But I tell you this, Mr. Speaker, if he really wants to support working people, maybe he should get off the picket line and end the strikes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The train service between Wilmslow in my constituency and London was always hourly, direct, and took 1 hour 50. Now you'd be very lucky if you got a direct train, and the journey time is double, or often double. And that's not restricted to strike days, that's day in, day out on Avanti trains. So can the Prime Minister tell my constituents what the government's going to do to sort this out and get the West Coast service back to what it used to be, because the service at the moment is completely unacceptable?
Mr. Speaker, my honourable friend is absolutely right about the unacceptable deterioration in the quality of Avanti's service. The Transport Secretary is rightly monitoring and holding them to account. There is a plan to increase the number of trains to 100 additional drivers, Mr. Speaker, and restoring the full direct service between Manchester and London. But what this plan needs, Mr. Speaker, and I hope the party opposite support it, is trade union cooperation.
Lyra Wilson.
Rubbish.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. I'm sure members opposite felt a certain sense of deja vu watching the Welsh defence during last night's match. After all, they know what it feels like to have Marcus Rashford run rings around them. Mr. Speaker, off the pitch, Marcus Rashford has been a tireless campaigner on child hunger. Yeah. So, in the face of fierce Conservative opposition. Yeah. So, will the Prime Minister, given that he delivered on the pitch last night, will the Prime Minister give him the best thanks possible by delivering free school meals for every child living in poverty?
Yeah.
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we're supporting almost 2 million children with free school meals. We also, last year, invested hundreds of millions of pounds in the new holiday activity and food programme, which is broadening that support through the holidays for those kids who need it, on top of our work to roll out breakfast clubs across the country.
Blake Drummond.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. The pandemic has played havoc with school attendance, and the Children's Commissioner says that almost 115,000 children are now being home educated, a 34% higher than before the pandemic, with little, if any, monitoring of their educational welfare. Even worse, 9 in 10 local authorities believe they have not been able to identify home-educated children. So when will my right honourable friend be bringing forward the register of homeschooled children so they're identified and we can be sure that their needs are looked after and they're not falling through the net?
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, we support the right of parents to home-educate their children, and we know many do well. But however, this is not the case for all, and that's why local authorities must seek to identify those children missing education. We've published guidance on the arrangements they should be following and indeed make sure that they have oversight of elective home education.
Catherine West.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. After record payouts last year to shareholders, the Royal Mail recently this year announced huge half-year losses and plans to cut 10,000 jobs while threatening the cherished universal service obligation, which guarantees a minimum six-day-a-week letter delivery service in the tradition of the Black Penny from 1840. Why has his government not yet committed to investigate the mismanagement and cack-handed mismanagement of this iconic British service and protecting its future and loyal postal workers?
Mr. Speaker, again, I have nothing but gratitude and appreciation for the hard work of our postal workers. But when it is not the right approach. It is not the right approach to go on strike, especially demanding pay, as we have heard, that is simply unaffordable for hard-working British taxpayers. The Honourable Lady would do well to see that, because in the context that we're in, it is simply not possible to give people the type of pay demands that they are making.
Andrew Percy.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Due to the unique geography of Brigg and Goole and the Isle of Axholme, we are one of the most flood-prone areas of the country. So whilst I welcome the record £5.4 billion of flood defence funding, can I ask, ask the Prime Minister, ahead of next year's budget, to look at easing the rules around how that money is spent so more of it can be spent on maintenance, which is so important to keeping my constituents dry?
Prime Minister.
Mr. Speaker, I'm very happy to look at that for my honourable friend. He's right to highlight the doubling of the investment that this government has put in flood defences, but it's right that we get the mix right between that, and I'll take that away with him.
Shalene Fletch.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The West Midlands Chief Constable has revealed that a vulnerable child was forced to spend 2 days living in a police station during a mental health crisis because the right specialist help could not be found for him. I know more and more young people are unable to access appropriate support for mental health. Will he accept Labour's plans to scrap private school charitable status and use the money to fund a mental health professional in every school?
Well, Mr. Speaker, I'd say to the Honourable Lady, we've already committed to offer all state schools a grant to train a senior mental health lead by the end of this parliament. Already 6 out of 10 have doing so. There's funding for all of them to have it. In addition to that, we're increasing the support that we give to those with eating disorders, because she's right, mental health does affect young people. This government is backing those people to get the support that they need.
Paul Bristow.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. The number of people crossing the Channel is a national emergency. The number of migrants in hotels is a national emergency. Isn't it time we had a Cobra-style committee involving the DWP, DLUHC, the Home Office and led by Number 10 to tackle this crisis?
Prime Minister.
Well, Mr. Speaker, I share my honourable friend's frustration, and I want to reassure him
that we will do whatever it takes to reduce the number of illegal crossings to this country, take any new powers that we need to. I look forward to working with him to ensure we can do that, because this is fundamentally about our sovereignty, Mr. Speaker, and the proper control of our borders. Whilst the Labour Party have tried to oppose every measure we have taken, we will keep going because we need to make sure that we stop the crossings.
Justin Oswald.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Last week, the UK Government's Regulatory Policy Committee stated that the retained EU law bill is not fit for purpose. The Institute for Directors, the TUC and countless others have urged the government to scrap the bill. And businesses across Scotland have already suffered severe economic damage under this Tory Brexit agenda, and they now see the outlook clouded with even more complexity and uncertainty. If the Prime Minister is serious about protecting the economy and looking after SMEs, why not do the right thing and scrap this disastrous ideological bill now?
Prime Minister. Well,
Mr. Speaker, actually taking advantage of our freedoms is going to drive growth and jobs and prosperity in the United Kingdom. Whether it's in life sciences, whether it's reducing the burdens on data for those SMEs, whether it's in the financial services industry in Scotland, that's how we're going to create prosperity across this nation, Mr. Speaker, and that's why we're going to get on and deregulate post-Brexit.
I'm going to come again, Mr. Speaker. My right honourable friend and the Chancellor have rightly pointed out that levelling up is for the whole of the United Kingdom. And as a Southampton man, my right honourable friend will know that since the 1970s, Eastleigh has been promised a much-needed Chicken Hall Lane bypass. So will he agree to meet me and Hampshire County Council to finally get this project moving?
Mr. Speaker, it's right that we spread opportunity across the country, including in Eastleigh and the South. I understand that it's for Hampshire County Council to bring forward the proposal for the bypass, which I hope they do at the next funding opportunity, and I'll ensure that my honourable friend and the Council have a meeting with the Transport Minister as soon as possible.
Final question on Brock.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Tory ideology has blocked onshore wind development in Scotland for years. Peterhead carbon capture clusters lost out in funding twice and still only classed as a reserve. Pump storage hydro schemes have been blocked because the UK government won't discuss a pricing mechanism. If the Prime Minister actually does care about net zero and cares about Scottish jobs, will at least take action to advance Peterhead CCS and pumped storage hydro in Scotland?
Mr. Speaker, not only are we supporting in this country carbon capture and storage, hydrogen, offshore wind, all new technologies that will help us get to net zero, all of which will create jobs in Scotland, we're also supporting our transition, Mr. Speaker, and that's good for the Scottish economy and it's good for Scottish jobs, and something the SNP would do well to support.
That completes Prime Minister's questions.
Well, that was indeed Prime Minister's questions. We're going to have a little chat with Beth Rigby, our political editor, in a moment about what we heard there and the exchanges. But some breaking news that happened during Prime Minister's questions. Eurostar security staff have voted to strike for 4 days in December over pay. Now, these are RMT members who are working as security staff for Eurostar. They're going to walk out on the 16th, 18th, 22nd and 23rd of December. So those, of course, are key days for those who would be thinking about going away the weekend before and the weekend of Christmas. The workers have rejected a pay offer. They earn £10.66 an hour, and they emphatically voted for strike action with an 81% yes vote. Now, the RMT General Secretary Mick Lynch says he said these security staff are essential to the euring of Eurostar. He says, we don't want to disrupt people's travels plans, but our members need a pay rise. This is the only way management will listen. He urges Mighty, who are the company that employ these security staff and Eurostar, to come to a negotiated settlement with the RMT as soon as possible. So on top of postal workers and train workers, nurses and ambulance workers, we're now hearing that Eurostar security staff, the latest bunch of people to strike over the Christmas period. Well, let's bring in our political editor, Beth Rigby, who is here to talk about Prime Minister's questions. And, Beth, strikes did come up in Prime Minister's questions. But what Kier Stammer really pushed the Prime Minister on was funding for private schools, the amount of money that could be generated if VAT was removed from them. And of course, targeting Winchester, which is the school that the Prime Minister himself went to.
I mean, it's curious in a way, Jane, in that he went on that, in that what's the issue for people on people's minds at the moment? It will be cost of living and strikes. But what Kier Stammer did there is, I think, develop an attack line that we are going to see again and again. And they've only gone up against each other a few times, but you can see what's happening here. Kier Stammer raised a policy issue. This is VAT on private school fees. Now, Labour have said that they will instate put VAT on fees if they win the election, a clear policy division between the Conservatives and the Labour Party. Labour think it would raise about £1.7 billion. But why did Kier Stammer, or the manner in which he did that, was both in a personal attack on the Prime Minister and an attempt to sort of frame Rishi Sunak again as someone that he argues is weak and is being pushed around by what Labour call invested interests, and in this case, being pushed around or giving money unnecessarily, in his view, to those private schools. But he used it in a way to remind us all that Rishi Sunak went to a very, very prestigious public school, Winchester College, because he used it as tax breaks worth £6 million. That was the point Kier Stammer was making to Winchester College, and he is trying to frame the Prime Minister as someone who protects vested interests instead of standing up to working people, but making it a personal attack as well of his own privilege. And they have done this in different ways, raising the issue of non-dom status. You remember Rishi Sunak's wife was a non-dom. She has since changed her tax status. And last week, people, not Kier Stammer himself, but Labour politicians, raising the issue of whether or not Rishi Sunak has private healthcare. So framing him, if you like, as a person of privilege who is out of touch, but also trying to find these dividing lines between Labour and the Conservatives, be it on the windfall tax, Labour talking about how they would have introduced it earlier, how much that would have raised, or public schools. Now, actually, to be fair to Rishi Sunak, he had a good rebuttal on that, in that he said, my parents worked very hard to pay those fees. His mother, a pharmacist, his father, a GP, to pay those schools to fees to one of the best public schools in the country. And he accused Kier Stammer of attacking aspiration, attacking people's aspirations. The second line of attack was, why don't you get tough with your backbenchers on house building? And he had the rebuttal again, Rishi Sunak, of, well, why don't you, Kier Stammer, get tough on Labour MPs joining the picket lines? But you can see now the contours of where Kier Stammer clearly thinks he can attack Rishi Sunak on. One is on privilege, and the second is on what he perceives as Rishi Sunak's weakness. These are two clear lines of attack that the Labour leader is now developing.
OK, Beth, thanks very much for taking us through that. Well, let's return to the subject of strikes. And in the last few moments, that breaking news that Eurostar security staff have announced strikes on the 16th, 18th, 22nd and 23rd of December in a dispute over pay. Well, in PMQs, the Prime Minister accused Kier Stammer of being in the pocket of what he called his union paymasters and being weak for not stopping Labour MPs joining picket lines.
He talks about toughness, Mr. Speaker. He's too weak to stop dozens of his own MPs joining the picket lines. So what, if he wants to support those hard-working families and show some leadership, why doesn't he confirm right now that no Labour MPs are going to join those picket lines?
Kier Stammer,
Mr. Speaker, whichever way you slice it, it's always the same. Whether it's private schools, oil giants, or those who don't pay their taxes here, every week he hands out cash to those that don't need it.
Well, I'm joined by some of those who are on strike to discuss what they have heard in the Commons. Ian Taylor is a postal worker who was on strike in Manchester. He's also the Communication Workers Union Divisional Officer for North Wales and the North West. And Ewan McGahey is a reader. There will be those who'll say that we need to adapt the postal service. Things have changed, haven't they, over the last few years? They've changed because of COVID. They've changed because people are becoming more adept at buying things online. The postal service does need to change. What would you say to those who say that you're not being willing to change with it?
It's a falsehood. It's an absolute falsehood to suggest that we don't want to change.
We made agreements. We've successively made agreements with the company to change. We had a completely fair agreement about modernisation. It was called Pathway to Change, actually, that this current leadership has walked away from. And anybody who knows Royal Mail will see that it has changed significantly, and we're more than happy to change.
What about Sunday deliveries? You don't seem very keen to do those.
Well, I don't believe that's true. I think if there is a proper conversation held about Sunday deliveries, then Sunday, I think the trade union fully understands why Sunday deliveries would be beneficial. It's how we propose to implement those Sunday deliveries.
OK, let's bring in... Sorry, Ian, sorry, I thought you finished your point there. Let's bring in Ewan talking to us from King's College. Why are you guys striking today?
Great question. So there have been over 25% real terms pay cuts since 2010 when this Conservative government began. So tuition fees for students have been rising and rising. They've tripled for home students. They've doubled for international students. But all the money is going not into their teaching, into teacher pay. It's been going into buildings that are fancy and shiny, but not caring about the people inside. It's been going into big management pay packets. So pay cuts are the first thing. The second thing is the failure to end the gender and race pay gaps. We've got over 17% difference in average pay between men and women in 2022. This has got to end. There should be equality through fundamental reform to childcare and paid parental leave. And the third big thing is job security. So many, especially younger early career researchers, have to apply for their jobs every year. It's one of the most insecure kinds of workforces at the moment. And university could just be so much better. We need to have an end to the management shutdown, an end to management of universities hoarding all the cash, and an end to this government shutdown in failure to invest in public education.
I mean, Ewan, what would you say to those who would say that, you know, because of the cost of living, life is just harder for everybody at the moment? Everybody is having to tighten their belts.
Well, university managements have had no problem in raising international student fees way above inflation. As I say, they've more than doubled the international student fees since 2010. And so there does need to be belt tightening from managements and people sitting on piles of cash around universities across the country. But fundamentally, what we need to see is an end to this failed privatized model of higher education. In the short term, what we need to do is have investment in teachers' pay by putting salaries up in real terms and stop hoarding the cash and putting into fancy buildings. And longer term, we need to abolish student tuition fees and talk about a national education service for everybody. And also, it's not just university workers, it's posties who are working harder than ever before, it's nurses, it's teachers. This government has presided over the worst real terms pay cut for the British public in modern history. Their level of failure is absolutely catastrophic, and the sooner that we've got shut of them, the better.
And in terms of the nuts and bolts, Ewan, I'm not going to ask you what you're paid, but what would be the pay of an average reader at somewhere like King's College be?
Well, look, that's a great question. And I'm now much more of a senior academic. And so for me, the reason why I'm out on strike today is not just about my circumstances, but especially for all the people who are going through early careers and have incredibly insecure jobs, incredibly low pay. So you have many people who will be earning less than the minimum wage, people who are doing incredible hours, but because of the way in which they're paid, actually they do more, much more than they're properly paid for. So it's not just about my salary, it's about growing
inequality. No, I'm not asking you yours personally,
divide.
Of course. I'm just asking you generally, what would be somebody in the kind of roles that you are doing, you're one of the people who are out striking, what would that sort of normal salary band be?
Well, to give you an example of a typical graduate teaching assistant, many of our members will be on something like £20,000 a year, £15,000 a year, particularly in London, where I am. It becomes incredibly hard to afford the rent, the soaring costs of energy bills, of course, because the government has failed to invest in renewable energy and clean energy infrastructure, makes it incredibly hard. And so, you know, university workers used to be in a relatively secure and well-paid job. But like staff across the country, this has been getting worse and worse since 2010.
OK. Ian, do you think you have the public support at the moment? Are you finding when you're out on picket lines that, that members of the public are coming up to you and saying they would like to see their posties paid more?
I think we've got a tremendous level of support when you're out on picket lines. People are constantly coming in and expressing that support openly to posties. You know, the posties deliver to 31 million addresses every single day. They are someone that the members of the public know and trust. So it is a most definitely something we believe is going to be important in this dispute going forward, and that is public opinion.
And what if the strikes continue? What if people's Christmas posters is affected? People don't get the Christmas cards, people don't get those presents that they've ordered online. Do you think the public will still support you?
I think the public see the bigger picture. I think they see the attack on postal workers. I think they'll take it in the round. And what I would say is postal workers are also people who will be affected. They're customers too. So I genuinely think the public will see the bigger picture here and the unprecedented attack on postal workers.
OK. Ian Taylor and Ewan McGaughey, thank you both very much for joining us. A bit of breaking news that I can bring you about something which happened yesterday. You may have seen, if you are on Twitter, that a lady who is called Ngozi Fulani was at an event at Buckingham Palace yesterday. She's tweeted about